moving average is a smoothing mechanism. There are different types of moving averages. You have a simple moving average, an exponential moving average, a geometric moving average. For this educational series, we're going to focus on the simple moving average. And really what it does is it adds up all of the closing prices and then divides that total by the amount of periods in discussion. So for example, if we're looking at a 200-day simple moving average, the way the formula works is that you are adding up the closing prices from the last 200 days of trading, and then you're dividing that number by 200. And that is the period, that data point in the moving average. Now, the next day, what you're gonna do is you're gonna add the new data point, the new closing price for that day, and you're going to subtract the closing price from 201 days ago. And every day that goes by, you're gonna do the same thing, hence why it's called a moving average. One of the things that I would like to reiterate is that this moving average is not for support and resistance purposes. This is something that we're going to discuss in a later module. The only thing that we're using a moving average for is to supplement the analysis that we're doing on actual price. The moving average is a smoothing mechanism. It smooths out all of those prices and helps us eliminate that noise. Why? For the sole purpose of helping us identify the direction of the underlying trend. That is the only reason why we're using it. So follow me here. We're going to take a look at an example of the solar stocks. This is the Solar Energy Exchange Traded Fund, cleverly named with the ticker symbol TAN. And here we have an uptrend in solar stocks throughout the second half of 2013. But we have a downward sloping 200-day moving average. So what we not only want to look at the direction of price, but we want to see in what direction that smoothing mechanism is heading. If prices are making lower lows and lower highs below a downward sloping 200-day moving average, it's probably not in an uptrend. And I think this is a great example, and if you could focus in right here, that breakout that we saw, we're going to talk about triangles in the pattern recognition segment. But in this case, when you had a breakout out of this consolidation, which as we'll discuss is a bullish, has bullish implications, the fact that we had a downward sloping 200-day moving average simultaneously was evidence that that breakout was likely to fail because the direction of the underlying trend is still to the downside. The next chart that we're going to look at is the S&P 500 going back a couple of years. This is in 2012. You can see that prices in the S&P 500 were in a clear uptrend, going from the lower left to the upper right. And the 200-day moving average is also upward sloping. While we're on the subject, I want to reiterate why it is that I use a 200-day moving average. And that's for my personal time horizon. Like I said before, I like looking out weeks and months ahead of time. I don't care what happened today. I don't care what happens next year. So the 200-day moving average is basically going to give me the average close from pretty much the last year, about 10, 11 months or so. So for my time horizon, I think it's great. A lot of people use a 50-day moving average. Some people use a 100-day or a 150-day moving average. And based on your time horizon, that might be right for you. For me, I like using that 200-day moving average. Paul Tudor Jones, one of the greatest investors of all time, also uses a 200-day moving average. So I guess I'm in good company. One thing I want to reiterate in this chart is that notice how prices within the uptrend in the S&P 500 on multiple occasions fell below that moving average. That doesn't necessarily mean that it's bearish. You'll often see headlines in the news about how a given market fell below a moving average or rose above a moving average. Without putting that into context, that doesn't mean anything. In this case, the fact that prices fell below the moving average, that was bullish because the moving average is heading higher. Those were opportunities to be buying weakness within an underlying uptrend. And these were two great examples. The last thing that I want to point out is when we have that flat 200-day moving average, that evidence of a lack of trend. And if you see here, we're looking at emerging markets in 2013, and we have no trend. We have a sideways trend. Well, we're not going anywhere. and you have that flat 200-day moving average right with it, that's evidence that there is no trend. And we want to avoid stocks that are near flat 200-day moving averages. There are a lot of lessons, guys, that I've learned from my predecessors, things that we're going to talk about here today, like Dow theory and moving averages and identifying trends. This is classic stuff. In this case, this is one lesson that I had to learn myself. Staying away from stocks that are trading near flat 200-day moving averages. If you want headaches, these are the stocks you want to be buying. If you want to avoid headaches, stay away from it completely. What happens is breakouts tend to fail. They don't hold to the upside. Breakdowns also tend to fail. They don't hold to the downside. You get a lot of whippy action. So if you find yourself in one of these environments, perhaps selling volatility or something like that might be in your best interest. But if you're in the business of identifying trends, if you're trying to buy things in uptrends, if you're trying to sell things in downtrends, when you see something like this, price near a flat 200 period moving average, from the bottom of my heart, just stay away.